You know that, how many times have you seen people saying, I'm going to give up on the business, I'm done, I can't do this anymore. And the moment they leave it and let it die, something happens. How many of you have ever seen that before? It's just something awesome about that. And I've seen it as well with people saying, I've invited my brother-in-law or my sister-in-law to come to church for so many years, and for years they don't show up. And then one morning I say, Lord, I'm not even going to invite them anymore. I give up. That service, they appear in the church service. How many of you have ever seen that before? Only a couple? I've seen it over and over again. I've been praying for my friends, for some of my friends for years. Praying, Lord, please let them come today. And I'll send a message. Say, hey, hope you can make it to the service today. And they usually stop replying after 10 times you've invited them. And they don't come. I mean, the one morning when you say, I'm not going to even invite them anymore, I give up. And I just give it to you, Lord, that there's no gebedsverzoek. I'm just going to pray about it. I'm not going to invite them anymore. I'm not even going to do that anymore. And the next moment you see them walking to church. You know, there's something funny about it. It's when we pray for something to happen in our lives. I know in many services that I sat in, I would pray and I would say, Lord, the man preaching is giving a prophetic word to everyone but me. And you know, when he will browse through all the people, you start moving a bit to the left, a bit to the right, just to get his attention. Or act as if you're chasing a fly or something. Look at me, give me a word. You know, you will just try and do something that he will see you so that he can give you a word. Because you are at church and you just want to get a word, you want to get a message from God. And with me, I see your hand, brother. That's why a preacher can't be a lifesaver. You know, if he goes to the beach and if he sees a hand, the preacher will say, I see that hand, brother. I see that hand. And no one will get saved. But like the rally's waving right now, that was what I was like in a meeting in a church service. And I was just praying that this man will give me a word because he gave a prophetic word to all of my friends. All of them are blessed. And here I am sitting in a service. I'm confused about my life. I don't know where I'm going to. I'm in Bible school for a year, but I have no idea what will happen after a year. And here I'm sitting, praying, saying, Lord, I need something from you. And you know what happened? The next moment I said, oh, you know what? The church service is over. He already prayed the last prayer to close the meeting. It's the last service. He was here for three services. And I was like, really, Lord? You know, every weekend, every time someone would come, I'm expecting to get a word from you. And he was here for three services. And not in three services, he called out everyone around me. And when you point like this and say, the guy sitting there, I'll act like, me? Me? And I said, no, not you. Not you. No, the guy next to you. I was like, really? And I was so expecting because I needed the word. And it was the last service of the last meeting for the weekend, and I was ready to get a word from the Lord. And again, you know, I even sat with different friends to make sure that he would invite me to get a seat in front somewhere. It didn't point his finger towards me. And I said, oh, Lord, I just give over. And how many of you have ever felt that way? You've been praying for something for a long time or praying for a certain thing and this doesn't happen. And then you say, oh, you know what, Lord, I don't even going to care about that anymore. I'm going to pray for something else. And the moment you do that, God says, okay, now you're ready to get a word. Okay. And the next moment I said, Lord, I don't need him to give me a word. I can hear directly from you. And the moment I said that, he said, wait, we're going to close. That guy on top with the khaki t-shirt. And I didn't even care anymore. I just said, okay, who's got a khaki t-shirt close to me? I didn't even care anymore. And the moment he said, no, you, the one looking around. And I said, me? He said, yeah, you come down, I've got a word for you. I'm not going to close the service, I have to give you a word first. And it's just funny, you know, it's just the moment when I didn't care anymore, somehow the Lord said, okay, now you're ready to get a word. Have you ever seen that happen in your life? And this morning, you know, I felt the same way. I felt many of us are here for a reason because we feel that it's important to get together this morning to celebrate the resurrection life of Jesus. And We are expecting today, not just to say thank you for what he has done, but we are also here to say, Lord, we appreciate everything that you've done. Until now, we don't just appreciate what you've done on the cross by giving your life for us and rising up into a newness of life. Not just for that, but we are thankful for every single day being our lives. Amen. I'm thankful because when I look back in the years of my life since the day I met you and when I gave my life to you, I can really see your hand in my life. And every year, every week, every month, every day, every hour, second, I can see where your hand brought me through for where I am today. And I'm not just thankful for everything else this weekend. I'm thankful specifically for that. The Bible tells us that, as we heard on Friday, what an awesome morning Friday was. It was a great morning with everyone that was here. But the Bible tells us that Paul had a revelation, how Paul would preach, and how these men would speak on the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. John said, I want to know nothing, and Paul said, I want to know nothing but Christ crucified. John said, when I was in the Lord's day in the Spirit, I saw the Lamb and the Lamb crucified. So I know that there's a lot of power in the crucified Christ. It was a day that my sins have been paid for. Amen. It was a day when I've been forgiven, when I've been healed and restored. And then I hear many other Christians speak and say, yeah, but he's not on the cross anymore. The cross is empty and the grave is empty. You know, my Jesus is alive. And I say, I agree. But let's not throw away the sacrifice, the lamb that was slain. The lamb that was slain is powerful in our lives. We have to understand that we can preach about the resurrection life, but we also need to know that there will be no resurrection if there is no death. See, let me start with this morning and not jump ahead of myself, but we have to understand that the resurrection life always seeks things that is dead. Die opstanding krag van Jesus soek altyd iets wat dood is. The resurrection life of God is always searching for that which is dead. Something that is alive cannot be resurrected. Why? Because it's alive. Only dead things can be resurrected. That's why it's not a funny thing. It is not weird or it's not strange. That is just the way God works. God's power is always searching for something that is dead. That is dead. That has breathed its last breath. That has given up. And not just given up, but that has given over. And in my life, I can testify on this, and I can share this the whole morning with you, but I can keep on saying that every time in my life where I felt I had no strength left, where I felt I had no power left, usually in that stage in your life where you will say, Lord, I can't do this anymore. Please come and take over. It is at that moment where we experience the power of God, the resurrection power of God, saying that it's good for you to feel the way you feel right now because now I can take over. See, so I'm praying and I'm asking, don't just declare that he is risen, but declare that he has died as well for you. And that is why Paul is convinced every time he speaks to the people, he says, for I am no longer alive, for I am dead. And the life I now live is Christ. He says, for I have been crucified with Christ. And the life I now live is Christ and Christ in me. I'm no longer alive. It is Christ that is alive in me. So we realize that Christ could never live in Paul if he did not die. If he did not die, then resurrection could never take place. So Paul had to die. Did he die physically? No, he died spiritually. So if Adam did not die in the garden spiritually, there was no need for Jesus to come and die and give his life. There would be no need. If we can on our own, in our own lives, be good enough to experience the resurrection power of God, then Jesus would never have to die for us. Can I share something with you? You have to die. I've seen many Christians live a life as if, I got this. You don't got it, okay? You can't. You can't do it by yourself. You cannot reach it by yourself. You cannot be holy enough by yourself. You cannot go to heaven by yourself. You cannot experience the power of God by yourself. You cannot experience healing, resurrection. You can't experience the power of the Holy Spirit by yourself. You cannot experience it by yourself. Somewhere in your life, you will have to get to a point where you say, Lord, I cannot do this by myself anymore. Lord, I cannot do it. I want to die. I want to die. I want to give over, Lord. And the Lord says, that's the best place where you can get is that you can't do it anymore. So let me now do it. See, but if I never die, I never give an opportunity for the resurrection power of God to be manifested in my life. And I want to tell you now, it's the worst feeling to feel as if you're dying, if you can't anymore. I can't do this anymore. It's the worst feeling you can ever experience. But it's the best place where you can possibly be for God to come and take over. See, the resurrection power of God can only manifest in something that has died. Doesn't the Bible say, unless a seed of grain falls into the ground and die, it can never grow? Doesn't the Bible say that? The Bible says if this seed of grain, if it never falls in the ground, if it never dies, then that plant can never grow. There's no way you can allow Jesus to grow in your life if you don't die. Is death pleasant? No. Death is not pleasant. It is not pleasant. Many people don't know it, but I've died once. It's strange to say once, but I died once. But I experienced the resurrection power of God in my body, and because of that, I can never be the same again. There's no way I can ever be the same again. I've experienced the resurrection power of God. We can go to Philippians 3. Philippians 3 verse 10. Hear what Paul says. Now there's so many things we can say today, but I'm excited to get to where I need to go. And I pray that we will truly experience the resurrection power. Philippians 3. Just hear what Paul says. Philippians 3 verse 10. He says, for my determined purpose is that I may know him. Look at somebody say, I want to know him. That I may know him. And just quickly see what it says in the Amplified, in the bracket. It says, that I may progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with him, perceiving and recognizing and understanding the wonders of his person more strongly and more clearly, and that I may in the same way come to know the power outflowing from his resurrection. So Paul explains to everyone, he says that I want to know him more. I want to be intimately acquainted with him. And the next moment he says, I want to know the power outflowing from his resurrection. There's no way I can experience the power of his resurrection without dying. Because resurrection only comes to things that are dead. Only dead things can be resurrected. That is why we can say, I am born again. Why? Because the old person that I was died. And the new life I have is in the resurrection power of God. That is how we are born again. But somewhere in my life, I had to die so that I could get the new life. And as I said in the beginning, it is not just a once-off thing. Amen? Dying in yourself is not just a once-off thing. Why? Because here Paul says that I may know, progressively come to know. It means every day, every second, every moment, I want to know him more. Not just one day when I died. I want to get to know him more every day. And here he says, I want to be acquainted with him. I want to experience the power outflowing from his resurrection. He says progressively. So how does he want to experience the resurrection power of God every day? Come on, can I get an amen? Every day. So dying is not just a once-off thing, the day when I accepted Jesus. The dying that Paul here speaks of is a dying every day. It's progressively dying to myself and giving over to him. It is silly to think as Christians that, yeah, but I have died and I am who I am now today. No. Being intimate with God tells you that you have been born again. But even a born again child of God is seen as a baby. And they drink milk, and then teeth is developed, then they eat meat, and then they grow and eat differently as a baby. I can't give a little baby meat. So I have to work with this little baby until they grow, and the more they grow, I can trust them with more things. See, so the child is progressively becoming like Christ. When I'm born again, I'm not immediately, boom, like Jesus. There's progress to become who I need to be. But Paul here explains, and he says that, and he said to everyone, what did he say? He said, I die daily. Thank you, John. He said, I die daily. So what do you mean, Paul? Because I am dying daily, I can daily experience the resurrection power of God. It sounds like a bad thing. I'm dying daily. And when we read it, we say, how many of you know that song? And it's as if we bear the cross of Jesus daily. It's not a bad thing. Why? Because if I can die daily, I can daily experience his resurrection power. Because somehow I know that if I am dying to myself in whatever situation it might be, that somehow the resurrection power of God will find everything that is dead in my life and resurrect it. Come on, if anybody says amen, you're going to get me excited this morning. Because what I saw in the scriptures suddenly became alive to me. Because over and over again, when I hear people quote the scripture, it's a sad thing. I die daily. But do you know that the resurrection power of God is also then there daily? It might be bitter, but it's sweet. Jesus died, it's bitter, but it's sweet. He rose. So if Jesus did not die, he could not give the resurrection power to every single one of us. See, as a child, I would get upset. I would get angry. And I would say, I would have joined Peter. But I wouldn't just cut his ear off. I would cut his arm off and whatever I could find. I would fight with Peter. You know, when I was a young boy, that's what I thought. Silly Pharisees and Sadducees, I'm so upset. How dare they kill Jesus? He was only good to them. And as a young boy, that is the way I felt. I was upset when I thought about them capturing Jesus and crucifying him. Instead of saying, thank you, Jesus, I would get upset. I would have fought for Jesus. Why? Because I did not have the revelation. See why many people are so against dying. Because they don't have a revelation. We are so against dying in ourselves. Why? Because you were like me when I was a young boy. I didn't have a revelation. I didn't understand that there is a resurrection power that will find and swallow up death, wherever death is found in my life. I didn't understand it. So I would go against dying. I would move against dying. Let me talk a little bit about dying. Can I do that this morning? Jesus tried to explain to us what dying was all about. He said, if somebody hits you on the one cheek, turn the other cheek. That requires dying in yourself. I promise you, and I know it would be degrading, it might be humiliating, and your cheek might burn for 5 minutes, both of them. But I promise you that the reward you'll get afterwards will be much greater than the slap in your face that you might have received. Even the second one. Double blessing. Double resurrection power coming your way. Now, I know I'm joking right now, but it tells you that even if your enemy asks you for a drink, the Bible says, give them water. And Jesus even tries to help us to understand this, saying that even if your enemy, someone who wanted to kill you, wanted to steal your life, destroy you, comes to you when they are thirsty and asks you for a drink, the Bible says, give it to them. And Jesus even says, and if you do it, let me help you. Let me help you to do it. If you do it, you're not doing it for them, you're doing it for me. Do you see how the resurrection power of God searches for that? In my life, I've seen it over and over again, where people would curse me and hate me, or spread stories about me, or treat me wrong, humiliate me. Immediately, I can be offended, I can get upset, I can get angry, and when that happens, it's only there to help me and say, you haven't died yet. Why are you getting so upset? You know what happened once to me? When I prayed, how many of you have ever felt that you can go to God and complain about everything? How many of you have ever felt that way? I felt that way. People treated me wrong, said things about me, and it wasn't the truth. And I felt I wanted to go and stand in front of everyone and take them on and fight. God said, And I said, Lord, this is hard, and this is bothering me. And you know what the answer was Jesus gave to me? He said, a dead man can't worry. A dead man cannot get hurt. A dead man cannot get offended. Are you still alive? Or are you dead and I'm alive in you? Because if I'm alive in you, you will allow me to fight your battles. Don't take up your own life again and try and fight all your battles. I thought you're dead. And I thought I'm alive in you. And you know what? Many times when I experienced that, and it was so awesome what Anton said. He said, you cannot crucify yourself. You need people to crucify you. Let me say it again. Anton said, you can hit the one nail into this arm. You can hit the nails into your feet. But you're going to need someone after you hit the nail into your feet and into your hand. You're going to need someone to hit in this nail. So don't get upset with people helping you to get crucified, helping you to die. Maybe God sent them your way to help you to die. Maybe God sent that guy to slap you so that you can learn. Because why would God then say, turn the other cheek if someone slaps you? It's to help you to die in yourself, to allow the resurrection power of God to manifest through you. I know it might sound very wrong what I said just now, God sent someone to slap you, but maybe God has sent someone into your life to help you to get to that point. Maybe God is sending you to someone to help them to get to that point. But this morning, I know I'm not preaching. I'm just really sharing what is in my heart this morning. But how many of us are really willing to die every day? Because many of us have the idea that, I died and Jesus is now living in me. But since that day, you started living your own life again. Since that day, you took control again. Maybe Jesus saved you and you were born again. But don't take control of your life again. The Bible says death is not just a one-day thing. That's why Paul says, I die every day. People cursed him. People tried to kill him. Over and over again, snakes bit him. People wanted to crucify him. Every day, he said, I experience death in myself every day. Every day I experience it. Quickly go to 1 Peter 1 verse 3. 1 Peter 1 verse 3. 1 Peter 1 verse 3. See, the Bible tells us that a true love and a genuine type of love teaches us to give everything we have. The Bible says that God so loved the world that He gave. Love teaches you to give. That God so loved the world that He gave His Son to die for sinful people, not holy people, for sinful people. So he gave his son so that his son could die. Now, true love and genuine love teaches us to give what we have. The Bible says, if you really love me, Jesus said over and over again, if you really love me, you will do as I say. Sometimes doing what God says takes some giving from your part. You have to give your time. You have to give away your idea of a situation. To do what? To do what you say, Lord. To be obedient to you, Lord. This is the way I do it. But if you say, do it this way, then I'll do it, Lord. It requires you to give what you have. And we just wanted to see this, how awesome this is. 1 Peter 1 verse 3. It says, praise and honor and blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By His boundless mercy, we have been born again to an ever-living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. From anew, so say from anew, or born anew, into an inheritance which is beyond the reach of change and decay, unsullied and unfading, reserved in heaven for you. Here the Bible says, praise be unto God, for we have been born again. How? Through the resurrection power of God. But there is no born again in your life if there is no death. There's no death. If there's no death, there's no born again. And I've experienced it in my life over and over again where I would ask something from God, like I shared with you in the beginning. I would ask, Lord, I just need one word, and He wouldn't call me out until I got to the point of saying, Lord, even if You give me a word, and even if You don't give me a word, it's okay. When I got to that point, immediately, it was as if the resurrection power of God searched for that kind of attitude. See, the word that would have come to me was looking and waiting for that attitude. It could not operate in the attitude that I had. Give me a word. Pick me. It didn't work. It didn't come until I got to the point where I said, even if I don't get a word. See, I have seen the power of God work on men that will say, even if I'm blessed today and even if I'm not, I will still serve You. Even if I get what I want, even if I don't get what I want, I will still follow You. Somehow it is that kind of attitude that makes everything worthwhile. Somehow it's that kind of attitude in men and people that I know that makes them powerful men and women of God. That they will not turn on God when they don't get what they want. And they will not turn on God when God upsets them or when something happens in their lives that they don't like. Somehow that attitude creates power in your life. Somehow it is that attitude that invites the resurrection power of God into your life. It is that attitude, even if someone hits me, I'll turn the other cheek, hit me again. I'm not doing this for you necessarily, I'm doing this for God. It is that attitude where you submit to God and say, Lord, I know that I cannot fight evil with evil, but I can only overcome evil by doing good. It hurts me. It kills me to bless someone that hates me. Praise the Lord for that. You're supposed to die so that He can live. It kills me to give someone food who would steal my food. It kills me to forgive someone who won't forgive me. It kills me to pray for someone that I know hates me. Am I getting through to someone this morning? It kills me to keep on loving someone, to keep on treating someone the way God would have, even if I know that they are not playing their part. Oh, but please, Holy Spirit, help me to get through to everyone this morning so that we can all understand this. Will you go to 1 Corinthians 15 real quick? I'm closing. 1 Corinthians 15. I want to ask, while I'm closing, can I ask the ushers to help me? And we can get all the buckets together. And we're going to take the buckets to the outside. And we have a tap here. We're going to fill it with water a little bit. And then we'll bring it back to you. Is that okay? So if the ushers can help me or the leaders can help me, we can get the buckets. And I know there might even be people here today, and you might not even have your own buckets here. But that's okay. We can share our buckets. Is that okay? We can share our buckets. We can make sure that everyone has enough. And what we are going to do is we are going to put water in the buckets. And then we will put all the buckets on the one side. Is that okay? We put all the buckets on the one side, on that side. And I want to wait for all of them to return and to get back. But I wanted to turn real quick to Matthew 27. Oh no, let's just go on with 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians 15. Go to verse 21. Verse 21. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 21. Hear what the Bible says. It says, "For since it was through a man that death came into the world, it is also through a man that the resurrection of the dead has come." Hear what it says. "For just as in Adam all people die, so also by virtue of their union of nature shall all in Christ be made alive." Now here the scripture tells me that through Adam, all people have fallen into the curse of death. But now it says that through one man, death came into the world, but through another, life has come into the world. Now let me explain this to you and let you understand that when death came through Adam. And everyone who would be born of Adam would experience that same kind of death. They would die. Now when Jesus came to the earth, the Bible tells us that he had to receive a body just like us. So that when he would die on the cross, that he would take up all the sin of the world, that he would take all the sicknesses, pains, and diseases upon that same body, so that he would die and give his life on the cross, so that all the sin of the world would die on that body. That all the sicknesses of the whole world would be in that body and die on that body when he would lay his life down on the cross. So Jesus had to receive a body just like us to do what? To experience everything we can experience. When you have to hear this morning, you must hear how awesome and how important this is. That Jesus had to experience every pain we would ever experience. Just imagine that. You know, some of us get flu and we are bedridden. But Jesus had to experience every kind of flu, every kind of cancer. He experienced every kind of pain, every kind of spasm, every kind of heartache, every kind of depression, every kind of stress, every kind of anxiety, whatever you can think of. He didn't just experience the pains in his body where he was whipped or where he was pierced or the crown of thorns. You have to understand that the Bible says that we have a high priest that is familiar with what we go through. So that when we go through our momentary afflictions, in my own translation, that He knows exactly what we are facing. Do you all hear this? Jesus had to go through every kind of heartache. Everything that you have experienced in your life, Jesus knows exactly what you're going through. Because He experienced it for you. Do you know that? Thank you, ushers. Thank you, guys. I appreciate it. So, as they are returning, do you all hear what I'm saying right now? Jesus experienced every kind of heartache. Whatever you're going through, you can never say, no one knows what I'm facing. Jesus faced it on the cross for you. And that's what the Bible says. That is why Jesus is a very present help to us, to all of us, when we go through trouble. Why? Because He knows exactly what you're going through. The heartache that you experienced in your life, where you felt, I cannot take this anymore. I cannot get through this anymore. Do you know that Jesus went through that exact same feeling? That heartbreak, that failure you went through. Do you know that Jesus exactly went through that for your sake? And that is why Jesus allowed that to die on His body, on the cross. That He had to become man, just like us, to experience the pain exactly the way we experience it. So that He could bring victory over it. So when Jesus took all of that upon Himself, He died with Him on that cross. That body was taken by a rich man into the tomb, was placed in the tomb. And in 3 days, when the people came to search for the body, the angel was sitting there and saying, go and look, the place where His body was lying is now empty. I want to share with you this morning that every kind of pain you might experience, that you might still experience in your life, Jesus allowed that pain to die on the cross with Him. So all of that have died. So what does this tell me? It tells me that if Jesus took that upon the cross and allowed to die with Him on the cross, it means that the resurrection power of God can now... Oh, yeah. Is anybody hearing this? Let me say it again. It tells me that if that what can ever come against me has already died on the cross when Jesus gave His life, it means that the pain that I might face in my life has already died in the body of Jesus. The depression that might ever come against me have already died in the body of Jesus Christ. And resurrection can only come to dead things. So this tells me that whatever I might face in my life, if it has already died on the cross with Jesus, that means that the resurrection life of God can now take over where that dead thing is in my life. And whatever can come my way, and that is why Jesus says, therefore, if any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. Even though you die, you will still have life. Oh, come on, somebody needs to hear this today. Someone needs to hear this today. Someone, if you get this, just say amen. I'm going to say it again. That the resurrection power of God, like I said, always search for dead things. Because only if something has died, then only can it be resurrected. Now the Bible tells me that all my sin, all my sicknesses, all my stress, all my depression, and when you get this, I want you to say hallelujah, because you have to act on what you receive. so that you can get through it, you can break through it. So this tells me then that if all of the things that I might ever experience in my life, or that I have ever experienced in my life, has already died in the body of Jesus, then it means that those things are dead. And when it comes my way, the resurrection power of God will find what is dead in me, and it will resurrect it into a newness of life. The thing that you might be facing right now doesn't need to die. It already did on the cross. Jesus already dealt with it. You can't tell me that Jesus will come and fight it for you. He already did it 2,000 years ago. That is why he said it is finished. When he said it is finished, he said, I've dealt with anything you might ever face in your life, ever coming your way. Well, whatever disappointed it must be, whatever hurt it can be, whatever sickness it might be, I have already dealt with it on the cross. I've already allowed that thing to die with me on the cross. And I've risen into a newness of life. You have no excuse not to step into the newness of life in your life. We have no excuse to let depression ruin our lives. Why? Because that depression already died on the cross with Jesus. We have no excuse to let sickness take over our lives. Why? Because Jesus already died. And that sickness died with Jesus on the cross. Come on, this is a revelation you need to receive this morning. The thing that you might be facing, the thing that might be holding you down, has already been dealt with. Don't let the devil lie to you, to taunt you into fighting the things that has come upon you. Jesus said it's finished. He already paid the price. He already allowed all of that to die in his body so that he can rise up into a new body. So that when we get this revelation, that we can say, I am done with my old life. I want to live in the resurrection life of Jesus. How can I live in that resurrection life? By allowing everything else that is dead in my life to be dead and to rise up in a new life. So where am I getting at? See, as a young boy, I had the wrong revelation. I got angry. Instead of saying, thank you for dying, Jesus. Somehow I wanted to stop him from dying when I was a young boy. But he had to die. I want to ask, don't let that same feeling be in your heart. Where Jesus is asking you, I want to be life in you. But in this area, you still have to die. In this area in your life, you are still so alive that I cannot take its place to become alive. Maybe Jesus is saying, I need you to die in this area of your life so that I can start living in that area. Maybe you are still so in control of your business. Maybe you are still so in control in your marriage. Maybe you are still so in control of your own life. That Jesus says, you are still far away from dying. You need to die in yourself so that I can live. You're still so in control of your children's lives that I can't help you to raise them. That I can't help you. You are still so in control of your emotions that you always get offended. Why don't you just die in yourself and let me live in your emotions? Let me live in your life. Let me live in your relationships. Let me live in your children. Come on, am I preaching to someone this morning? Resurrection life can only come to that which is dead or willing to die. And here we see Jesus doing exactly that. Doing what? You're the King of Kings. The Lord of Lords comes to his disciple and all the rest of the disciples. They all get together. And I think Jesus started to pick up the wrong attitude in the midst of the disciples, in the midst of their congregation. Because some of them started asking questions, who's the most important in the kingdom of God? How many of you know those scriptures? And suddenly something came up in the disciples asking who's the most important. Yet John writes, he says, the disciple whom Jesus loved in his own book was lying on the lap of Jesus. The disciple whom Jesus loved. And it was almost as if there was a little bit of a competition between the disciples. You know, Peter lost all the way, okay? Get behind me, Satan. He sank, you know. I think Peter didn't have a very good self-image of himself. But that was something he had to deal with as well. Let me say it this way. Isn't it strange how people in Afrikaans, we say, the swak self-beeld. And we say, oh, shame. But to see yourself in a bad light, you might think it's a bad thing, but it is almost self-righteousness. Let me say it again. Maybe today this can get somebody free. I struggled with it for a long time. I had this inferior look, an outlook upon myself, thinking I have all these limits, I'm not good enough, I have this and this. That almost destroyed me, that put me in a place of depression. But when God spoke to me one day, he said, how dare you think this of yourself? Why can you not die in yourself and see yourself the way I see you? The next moment I was set free. Why? Because it's like a pity party. And it's only you and the devil at your pity party. And I'm not good enough. And the devil says, yes, you're not good enough. You will never be. And he rubs your head. And he says, yes, devil, nobody loves me. He says, yes, you're right. Nobody loves you. And you have this attitude. And it's you and the devil at your pity party. It's actually self-righteousness, hidden sin that gets you to that place. Until Jesus challenged me and said, it's time for you to give over. You are so in control of your life that it turned, your self-righteousness turned into depression. And then it fools you that no one can help you get out of it, because depression is not a death. Depression is not dying. Depression is controlling. And God says, it's time for you to get resurrected. So right now, I want to explain this to you, because there were certain people that Jesus had to work with around that table, in that room. Here we have John, we have James, we have Peter. When you think of all of them, even here we have Judas. And it's strange to see all these types and figures, because Peter might have had a very bad image of himself, thinking, I'm not good enough, I keep on failing, I sank in the water. He called me devil a couple of times. Once, not a couple of times, but he called me a couple of times. Things happened that shouldn't have happened. And Peter might have felt, I'm never going to be good enough. And here we see that Jesus took all of them into a room. And it was the last night before he was crucified. And why are we putting all of this together? Why are we washing the feet on Resurrection Day? It doesn't make sense. People ask me, but why are we going to do it on Resurrection Day? Aren't you going to preach on the resurrection power of God? Yes, but there cannot be any resurrection if there's no dead. Okay, you're getting there. So the next moment, God spoke to me And I said, we're gonna call it a feet washing service. And I realized that here Jesus took another death. He did it over and over again. He was a king who became a man like us. That is already a death, that you must die. A king who will leave your throne to come to the earth to experience such sin. Already, that was a type of death for me. He died on the cross. But even before that, he would die in himself once again and show everyone, it is great for me to experience this kind of death. And Jesus loved doing it. Oh, I hope I'm getting through into your hearts this morning. I'm speaking into your hearts. Jesus enjoyed always being the least. He enjoyed always serving. He enjoyed caring for people. He enjoyed sitting with the sinners. He enjoyed sitting with the drunkards. He didn't care if somebody said things about him. He didn't care. See, there's some kind of maturity in dying. There's a maturity that comes into your life when you start dying to yourself. And people can't always understand it. It's hard for them to understand. How can you still smile if all hell is breaking loose in your life? How can you still be happy if everything is going wrong? It's just a kind of death that you cannot explain to people, but it brings maturity into your heart. It's a bit of maturity when you turn the other cheek and say, it's fine, hit me again. But by doing it, I'm going to get through to you and you're going to get saved. I remember once people phoned me over the phone, 2 o'clock in the morning, started cursing at me and shouting at me over the phone, telling me how bad I am and this and this and this. And I said, what's your name? And my name is Peter. And I said, well, Peter, thank you for phoning me 2 o'clock in the morning. Now I can pray for you the rest of the night. Bless you. He put the phone down immediately. After he sweared at me, after he shouted at me, I thought, what just happened? And I thought, okay, well, I'm going to pray for him. So, you know, Catherine Kuhlman always said whenever attacks would come against her in her life, she would immediately stand up, walk out of her house, and go and pray for people. She said as soon as she started doing that, attacks stopped coming against her. Because the plan the devil had backfired. See, the devil had a plan to crucify Jesus, put him in a grave. And like I preached a while ago, that the tomb was not a grave. The tomb turned into a womb. And maybe you might experience and think that the things that's trying to kill you is not really going to kill you. It is just launching you into a new level in your life. It's just raising up a new level of maturity in your life. When the devil thought he was winning against Jesus, he was actually failing completely and miserably. And I want to say this morning, whatever attacks have been coming against you or your family, it is not over. It's just a setup for your biggest victory. That's what happened with Jesus. When they thought it was the devil thought it was his greatest victory ever won. It was actually the greatest victory Jesus won. See, somehow God has the way of turning your tears into laughter, turning things around to benefit you. The Bible says, whatever might happen against you or towards you, God will turn it around to at the end benefit you. So dying is not easy. It's not always fun. But God can turn that dying around into life because He's the one. He is the power. He is the resurrection. Jesus said, for I am the resurrection. When Mary said, will you raise up Lazarus? Jesus said, I am. I am. Look at somebody say, I am the resurrection. And here Jesus came with all his disciples. And the next moment he thought, let me bring this fruit to them. The day before I get crucified, he went down on his knees, the Bible says. He took his robes off, his kingly robes. He took a servant's towel, put the towel around his waist. He went down on his knees. And what did Peter say? Peter said, Lord, you will never wash my feet. I will never allow you to do that. I will never let you wash my feet. You are not that low. You are high. I'm supposed to wash your feet. And yet again, Peter fails miserably. And Jesus says, if you don't allow me to wash your feet, then you have no part in me. Peter, okay, Lord, don't just wash my feet, wash my hands, wash my face. Give me a all over. See, and Jesus teaches us how blessed it is. And he said, if any one of you want to be the greatest, then you have to die in yourself, become the least. Become the least. There was no lower thing you could do. There was no lower job description that you can think of. Because usually when people would walk into a house, they would wash their own feet. But in rich homes at that time, they had slaves who would wash the people's feet. It was the lowest job description, lowest paid job description you could think of. And Jesus decides to take the lowest of lowest job descriptions. Stoop down that low. And many of them were surprised. Why would you wash my feet? It's never nice to wash somebody's feet. Is it nice? It's not nice. It's not comfortable, but he decides to stoop down to the lowest of lowest of lowest to show them, I'm willing to give it all up. Some of you won't even wash somebody's faces, but I will wash your feet. Some of us will never even forgive someone if they hurt you. Jesus says, I'm going to wash your feet. Judas, even if I know you're going to get them to catch me and crucify me, even if I know you are, I'm still washing your feet. Come on, how many of you will wash somebody's feet if you know they hate you? How many of you will do it? How many of you will bow down on your knees and move to the lowest of lowest that you can possibly go to wash somebody else's feet that have cheated you wrong lately? How many of you will do it? It takes dying to oneself to really experience the life of Jesus. And I know it might not be easy to stoop down that low or go down that low, but I promise you, by doing that, you will experience the love Jesus has for that person. That's the only way you can ever get to that point in your life. That's the only way how you can really experience how Jesus loves someone. Bible says he loves us even while we were sinners. Now, I want you to sit with the people that whose feet you're going to wash this morning. Let's make it family by family. If you are here alone today, doesn't matter. Go and sit with someone. If you see someone sitting alone, call them to come and join you. Can we do that? We have the buckets in front, so we're going to take our shoes off. And today we're going to do what the Bible says. We're going to say, Lord, we're going to wash each other's feet. And Pete, I think you can also even go and sit with Amila and your family. And we're going to put up a song at the back. For those watching via live stream, wherever you are, get a bucket of water. Go and sit with someone in your house. Sit with them. You can take their shoes off. And then I wanted to really sit with them. We're going to play some music so we can put the cameras all over the people this morning. I'm going to go and sit with my family. And we're going to wash each other's feet. And when we do that, and when we do it this morning, I wanted to really look at the person and say, whatever I have not forgiven you yet for, maybe you haven't. Maybe there's still something in your heart. Maybe there's still unforgiveness in your heart. Maybe you are still struggling with something. If there is, today we are walking out of this building completely forgiven. Amen? Whatever you are harboring in your heart, you're going to say, I forgive you. I forgive you. And you're going to ask and say, please forgive me of any sin. Come on, today it is finished. Today it is finished. The past is over. All the other things, it's over this morning. Can we do that this morning? Okay? So I want to ask, there's people here who do not have buckets. But if after you have washed your feet and your spouse or your friend's feet, I want to ask, please go and throw out the water, fill it up, and go and look for someone who do not have a bucket and give them the bucket. Can we do it that way this morning? Okay, so we're going to take 10 minutes to wash each other's feet. But we all have to do it this morning. And after we've done that, we're going to get together, and we're going to drink and have communion, and we're going to go home. But can we do it that way? Who does not have a bucket here? Is there anybody who do not have one here this morning? Is anyone? Okay, there's a couple of people. Okay, so just be patient and wait. After we've used the buckets, after we've finished, we're going to wash them out and bring it to you. Amen? Is that okay? So right now, I'm going to stop talking, but just sit with your family. Have a special time with them. Let there be complete forgiveness and restoration. And pray for one another and bless one another. Amen. I see there's still people busy. Let everyone receive a bucket of water. Is there anybody still who needs a bucket of water? Anyone, if you can just lift up your hand. Is everyone helped? Everyone washed? Oh, man. How many of you just experienced the Lord when you were doing it? Did you experience it? Oh, thank you, Jesus. The resurrection power. It's time. It is time. You know, it is time for the resurrection power of God to manifest in our lives. So if you have your cup and if you have your bread with you, I see there's still a couple of people who need to get. But let's all stand together. And as we stand, we're going to eat of the body of Jesus and drink the blood of Jesus. And specifically, this morning, as we have shared in communion the last couple of days, it's so wonderful to know that the Lord is in the details, like we all heard Friday. If you could not be here Friday morning, please go on to Facebook and go and watch the service. It was really amazing. And I know you'll be blessed. If many of you don't really know what happened on that day and how the preparation worked, it will really bless your heart to go and listen to the whole service. And today specifically, I want to pray for the whole body. The body of Jesus resembles and speaks of all of us. And it tells us that his body was broken so that our body can be made whole. So this morning we say, Jesus, thank you that you died on the cross. Thank you that your body was broken so that our bodies can be healed. We pray for all the members in our church, all the, our friends, our family, for those who are hurting. We are praying for wholeness. And we thank you for your body that was broken so that we can receive the healing and the restoration power in Jesus' name. Your body died so that ours can be resurrected in Jesus' name. You're welcome to eat of the body of Jesus. And so then we also want to say, Jesus, thank you for your blood. Thank you for your blood that flowed, that forgave us of all our sins. I pray, Lord, help us to forgive in the same way for those who have hurt us or who have disappointed us. Help us to forgive all of them and every person, Lord. Thank you that also today that we don't just forgive everyone else, but we also forgive ourselves. Of the times that we've missed it, the times when we made wrong decisions, I pray and I want to say thank you for your forgiveness for ourselves as well. That your blood washed away all our sins and cleansed us. Your blood brought us very close again in a relationship with God. We thank you for your blood in Jesus' name. You're welcome to drink the blood. Thank you, Lord. So as we're standing, let me close. Lord, I thank you then for all of us standing here this morning that we can celebrate your resurrection power. But Lord, as we heard this morning, there can be no resurrection if there is no dying. So I thank you, Lord, that you will help us to die in ourselves every day, as Paul says, so that we can experience your life every day. I know Andrew Murray once spoke and he said that the amount of God that you will experience in your life is the amount you let go of your own. And I thank you today we can receive your fullness of life. We pray for resurrection power in our relationships, in our bodies, in our businesses, in our families, in our churches, in our schools, in our cities, in our country, in this whole universe, this whole world. We pray for your resurrection power in Jesus' name to be our portion. For us to live a newness of life. You said, I've come to give you life and life in abundance. We thank you for that resurrection life right now in Jesus' name. Amen.